During the events of the American Zombie War, Las Vegas would be completely lost. So much so, in fact, we would have to call it Lost Vegas. God. With numerous casualties on both sides, eventually the entire city would have to be walled off. Just prior to the first outbreak happening, an accidental quarantine breach would take place during the transfer of what would spark this whole thing off. Shortly after the walls were constructed, the discussion of what to do with those infected remained. While some organizations wanted to move in and secure what they were originally working on, others, like the president, would want to nuke the area off the map on the 4th of July because, if you think about it, it'd be pretty patriotic. However, prior to the nuke dropping on the city, which, see, I told you we should just nuke Las Vegas, a small team would be sent in to retrieve a specific version of the infected as it represented the culmination of all the work they were conducting in Area 51, unbeknownst to them. This team would ultimately come across some pretty strange infected whose origins actually do make sense considering the presenting characteristics they display. So in today's episode, it's pretty clear what we're talking about, the Army of the Dead infected, and specifically some of the ones that if you weren't paying attention, you may have just straight up missed, and what that means for the rest of the infected. So as per usual, everyone knows what I'm about to say, but for you new people, up on screen you'll see a timestamp of where to head to if you want to bypass the summary. Honestly, this movie was pretty good, but man, I don't think it needed to be almost 2.5 hours. I felt like a lot of it was filler at some points, but that really doesn't matter. So anyways, you can head there or look down at the chapters in the bar, whichever, really doesn't matter. Alright, so let's get to why the military really needs to install some skid plates on the bottom of their super trucks if a freaking car can cause them to release massively dangerous cargo out into the world. We start off our story at Area 51. A convoy is headed out to an unknown destination. Meanwhile, a couple just got married in Las Vegas, which historically marriages will last forever if you go to the drive-through chapel. Across the way, the soldiers are discussing about what they are hauling. They aren't really too sure as they've been told nothing. Meanwhile, the couple start doing the do, and then back at the soldiers' convoy, the two are talking about how they could just be hauling an alien, or maybe the original Declaration of Independence, who knows? Anyways, the guy driving drops the ball and doesn't focus up. I mean, I can't blame him, and then he ends up just kind of, you know, specifically taking out the truck with the cargo. What was the Humvee up front for? Who knows? That's the fun. After a fiery explosion, the container is compromised as another soldier radios in. Over the radio, the woman tells them to get everyone that can move and then get away from it immediately. Anyone who can't walk is to be left behind. As the soldiers approach, the door opens and a creature is released that immediately begins taking them out. Round seen almost completely useless against this thing. Two soldiers end up running off, but they run like 100 yards and then one soldier's like, oh, okay, we're far enough. One guy's like, are you sure? He's like, yeah. Yeah, bro, that seems like a far enough distance. Oh, wait, it is. They're quickly attacked and then turned by what is essentially the Alpha. Shortly after their transformation, they move over and then see Las Vegas is ripe for the picking. Meanwhile, in Las Vegas the next day, everything appears to be totally screwed. Gonna have to blur out some of this, but basically the entire place is getting overrun Zombieland style as the Alpha walks through the area. A war then kicks off between the military and infected, and also this war, I mean, it just seems like bad planning. I mean, just keep using missiles, right? They end up dropping soldiers into a massively infected area with a dome parachute that can't be controlled. Maximum oof. But eventually the military are pushed back over time. The area is completely lost. There's a subplot of a mother looking for her daughter. But yeah, it doesn't go according to plan as they get straight up crushed just a few feet from the exit. Also, pretty big oof. Presumably months later, we meet Scott. One of the people who managed to survive the outbreak within the city is now flipping burgers. As he continues working, a man enters the diner named Tanaka, and they have an offer for him. Get a team together and retrieve the money from a vault in a casino. The government has elected to nuke Las Vegas, so he's interested in getting that money out, and if he's successful, he will get 50 million of it. Meanwhile, in Las Vegas, there's a camp that has been set up literally on the other side of the wall from zombies. Seems like, I mean, that seems like a bad idea, right? Like, literally, it's just a wall. I mean, no, just put the whole desert between me and that. Kate is a volunteer there, and as she discusses with Jita, a mother, this guard who's Mr. Hardass is measuring everyone's temperature to make sure they're not infected. Basically, my boy is just power tripping, as you know. Kate is trying to talk the mother out of going into the city to get money to get her kids out of this camp, but we all know how that's going to go. Meanwhile, Mr. Meathead is having a nightmare about his wife. She was apparently turned in the house, so he ended up having to dome her with a knife, and we see that Kate was also there. Super sad about the whole thing. Scott then calls Mr. Tanaka under the name Possible, which may imply other teams have been asked, and he says that he's in. Now we get the old getting the boys back together cut through, you know. I prefer the scene in MacGruber where the whole team just gets blown up at the end, but this one will do. He offers varying amounts of money to the team to get them enticed, which obviously works. Oh, and by the way, the pilot, they actually had to superimpose her over. I forgot the original guy in the movie, but he turned out to be a disgusting pile of shit. So literally, they just straight up removed him. Pretty impressive. So the guy who's supposed to crack the safe, his name is Dieter, not important, but that's my father-in-law's name. Never seen another Dieter. All right, so back on track. So the team then gets the setup. They are to enter the casino, get the money, head up to the roof to an abandoned helicopter. Dieter asks how they really do the zombie ending. Scott tells him just go for the brain, an old standard. As long as that's destroyed, you're good to go. They show how the plan should go, which, how do you think it's gonna go? A security detail is then sent in from Tanaka, and his name is Martin, and he will be accompanying them as well. Back at the camp, Scott goes to see his estranged daughter, Kate, and then tell her he's got a job coming up. He promises her $50 million if she helps him. Meanwhile, the mother from earlier is attempting to get into the city to get the money so she can get her kids out. It's a lot of gets. Kate then jacks a bus to get the team into the camp to retrieve what they need. They appear to be the only bus heading in while everyone else is heading out, not suspicious at all. And as the security guy tries to get to know Chambers, she says she doesn't trust him. And I break away for a moment. Have you ever just not trusted someone and you don't know why? Well, some call it instinct, some call it a gut feeling, but there's actually an interesting story with this. They're known as mirror neurons. There's a hypothesis out there that actually in certain people with mirror neurons, and this is not just what I say, there have actually been studies conducted, they have the ability to somewhat read other people's minds. Now, I know it sounds insane, but what they may actually be doing is looking for movements, social cues, and actions so small that they're imperceivable to our senses at large. But to the mirror neurons, they may not be, which kind of actually relays the person's intent. Because if the person intends to harm in a way, they may not be thinking they are showing it, but their body language gives them away. These neurons read this, and that's what gives you that weird feeling about people. So sometimes you should just trust your gut. But back to it, as they reach the camp, everyone is pretty much getting mobilized to GTFO. The team meets up with Lily as Kate tells them not to get nuked and then walks off. Eventually, she comes across Gita's kids and they tell her the mom is gone. Assuming Lily is involved, she goes and punches her across the face, which I mean was a solid connection. And Lily says that she took them in because they need money. Gita didn't tell Lily though that she had kids, but I mean, it's a pretty small camp. Shouldn't you kind of know that? Kate decides that she's coming in with her dad and the team to look for Gita. Scott then relents, but says that she can come along. Lily says that they need one more guy. The guard walks up and Lily asks if he wants to make 20 grand, which of course he does. His power tripping is then checked by Vanderhoe, and then they all move into the city carrying gas tanks for the helicopter. As they open the door, they're expecting to charge, but really they just find a bunch of desiccated infected. The shamblers were not smart enough to get out of the sun, but when it rains, they come back to life for a few hours. And this is crucial to figuring out what these things are infected with, so keep that in mind. As they walk through the abandoned roads where the military fell, they hear roaring. A freaking infected tiger is walking around surveying the area. It ends up leaving, and Lily turns to the guard and asks to see his force multiplier. She flirts with him, and then he hands it over, and she immediately pops him in the leg and zip ties his hands. She starts talking about how they have to send an offering to the alphas. They leave him out in the open and then quickly hide as they hear a yell. Two alphas arrive to inspect the area, finding the guard hogtied. Sensing it is indeed an offering, they take him off to their lair. Lily then says that even though it was accepted, they need to get off the streets as it's a sign of disrespect, so they need to head inside of buildings. She also says that she's not sure how it works, but they take them off to Olympus and then turn them into one of them. Tig then starts asking who's the most important, just after witnessing the dude get sacrificed, but back over to Bert, he's not having a good time. The Mega Alpha shows up and inspects the sacrifice. He checks out, I guess what is his queen, and I mean, since he's listening to her stomach, I'm assuming she's pregnant, so zombies can get pregnant. Haven't seen that since Dawn of the Dead. Bert is then thrown into an empty pool area where he's grabbed and taken off to some fate, which we will see later. Back in the building with the team, a ton of shamblers are inside, just kind of standing around in a basic comatose state. Okay, so Dieter yells at this point, which doesn't wake them up, but the light will wake them up and conversations will wake them up. So why didn't the yell wake them up? I'm starting to sound like WowSuch Gaming over here with the zombie sins. As Chambers moves through, the guy sent in by Tanaka throws the glow stick that they were using to navigate by down another hallway. As she moves through, she has to take out multiple infected as they keep waking up. And as she takes out one of them, their arm lands on a pan. As the team continues through, eventually the pan is knocked down, awakening everyone and turning it into a massive fight. Running and force multiplying, Chambers ends up finding her way out, then is blocked by Martin, who locks her in like a real douche. Eventually, she is able to break a window, but is surrounded. Guzman just kind of watches without, you know, firing a shot till it's like way too late. Like, bro, what are you doing? Then he puts a round in her gas tank, detonating it, and then taking out the horde. Already down two, they make their way to the building with the vault. The place seems more abandoned for the moment with just a few stragglers. As Dieter looks around, he finds blueprints for the vault, which means Tanaka had possibly sent in other teams before them, which means the possible name on the phone call kind of confirms that there were others. Heading outside, they find the helicopter, which appears, as Tig puts it, a hunk of junk. May have probably been something they needed to check prior. Lily and Martin then head off to do Martin's actual rescue mission. Lily fires a shot in the air to alert the alphas of their presence. Scott attempts to bond with his daughter at the generator about running a food truck, but then he tries to, you know, talk to Kate about her mom, but she's still pretty pissed that he ran off and didn't talk to her afterwards. So that reconnect just totally failed. Scott fires up the generator for the building, and I just want to point out there's still a ton of infected around, which... I don't know, seems like a bad idea. They enter the vault area where Dieter ends up saving Guzman's tail. Dieter then uses a card to open the security door and check out the vault at the end of the hallway. Also, there was another team of grave robbers. Clothes look familiar, eh? Vanderhoe mentions how it's basically just them, just from another timeline. So I should warn you, this movie is like 10 tons of crazy. All right, so back out on the road, Lily and Martin are approached by two alphas. Dieter finds the trigger plates for the non-lethal deterrent, by the way. And even further away, Zeus, the real alpha, finds Jita and her group and abducts him. As the other alphas approach Lily and Martin, seeing there is no sacrifice, they have to open fire on the male alpha, taking him out. Headshots actually do still work, and the queen is subdued by metal cabling. Martin flips her over and then cuts off her head. So Matt, you're probably gonna have to blur this one. She yells, and Zeus is alerted to the crap that's happening. Martin takes the head to try to get ahead in life, but it's sort of like that one guy who stole raptor eggs in Jurassic Park 3. It's just not a great plan. So Vanderhoe now brings zombies down for Dieter to attempt to get them to activate the pressure plates. He microwaves a hand and figures out it's not the meat, it's the heat that they are attracted to. As a zombie walks, they figure out the non-lethal isn't so non-lethal. Between force multipliers and crushing walls, it really would have been kind of a bad time. Meanwhile, Tig tries to get the chopper up and going, but it's a piece of junk. Upstairs, the team gathers around a TV as the nuking has been moved up a full 24 hours, despite how cool and patriotic it would have been to drop a nuke on the 4th of July. Scott radios to Tig and tells her of the new information, and she says that the helicopter is going well and that they shouldn't be alarmed at all, but they probably should. Back down at the vault, Scott asks how Dieter is doing, which he needs absolute quiet and roughly 30 minutes to crack it. If he messes up again, it locks forever, so that's probably not good. Back out in the streets, is that a zombie horse? Well, there are zombie tigers, so why not? Zeus finds his queen headless and then listens to her stomach lamenting that he can't hear it anymore. Scott and Kate make sure that the exit is clear, and then they find some extra money in the casino that is just basically straight up theirs now. While doing that, Dieter is able to get the vault open, and everything appears to be good to go. But usually when everything is going good, that means it's about to go really bad. Also, Lily grabs the cash counter and looks at the queen's head. Important foreshadowing. Opening the vault, critical mission success. Zeus carries his queen's body back to Olympus and opens her abdomen to find a fetus that is blue in coloring, pretty much wears off after being removed. So now the horde is pretty upsetty spaghetti. Also, Scott reconnects with Anna, or my girl Maria Cruz, and as Scott turns around to look for Kate, she's gone missing and is outside. The horde is now on the move for vengeance as ordered by Zeus. Kate runs towards the Olympus building to get her friends as the horde storms the building that the team is in. Scott hits the elevator button, but as he does, an infected jumps out and grabs Anna, and holy sweet Christ, just turns her head around so far her freaking like thoracic spine is yanked up in her. God, that was brutal. Scott takes out the elevator as they have to leave because presumably more are coming down. Vanderhoe and Dieter run towards the vault as infected begin pouring in, and as the rest of the team tries to run, Martin traps them in a room with the infected and then goes to kill Tig. Also, at this point, the Alpha has found them. He approaches Dieter and Vanderhoe as Vanderhoe goes on the offensive, but it's a lot like when Arnold tries to fight the Predator. Monsters be strong, man. Before he can bite Vanderhoe, Dieter then smacks the Alpha and locks Vanderhoe in the vault. As Martin heads outside to get to the chopper, he realizes that the bag feels a little strange. He checks and realizes that it was actually changed with a money counter. As he checked, the infected tiger shows up and it's snack time. After a short attack, it eventually crushes his head with a bite and eats his face. And we might be able to sneak that one by, but that's probably gonna have to be blurred. Back at ground level, the team comes across the rest of the horde, which really makes you wonder how Martin was able just to walk out front. As Scott continues to decimate them, Guzman is attacked, and then he lights up one of the zombies. And did you see that? Is that the Terminator? Could be. We'll talk about it. Guzman is bitten, so he's done. So he elects to pull the pins on his grenades and take out quite a bit of the horde in the process. Zeus now exits the elevator and sees that his people aren't doing so hot. Or are they? Because they're on fire. And Kate goes to check around the Olympus, where she runs across our old pal Bert. Scott and Lily exit the roof, and she holds up a force multiplier to the queen's head to stop the alpha from attacking. As Tig and Scott take off, Lily becomes distracted, and then the alpha pins her with a piece of rebar. She drops the queen's head off the side of the building, basically making the alpha ridiculously angry. Scott directs Tig to the Olympus and that they need to get Kate. Kate ends up finding Jita and her group as they were abducted, and Zeus heads back to the Olympus as well. Scott is then dropped off on the roof and then heads into the building. Bert finds them first and bites Sadie. As Bert goes to attack Kate, she ends up doming him, but sees the Alpha has just found them. As Gia tries to open the door, it's stuck. Luckily, Mr. Macho Man Dave Bautista is there to Swolder status the door and Noob Tube the Alpha. Exiting the top of the building, they find Tiga's left, but not really. She was in the process of leaving, but then decided to come back for them. As they go to leave, the Alpha jumps on the helicopter. A fight ensues as they try to get out of there, but Scott misses every freaking shot on this thing, except for the one where he wings the pilot. The Alpha then breaks Scott's arm as Tig watches the nuke heading inbound, and the Alpha bites Scott, infecting him, but gets distracted by the nuke blast that just detonated, which gives Scott time to line up a shot and splatter the blue brains. Interestingly, there's blue brains. The shockwave causes the helicopter to crash. Tanaka has received no call, so technically, now it's a critical mission failure, and we will get him next time. After the crash, Tig is gone, Gita is gone, Scott's infected, and Kate is injured. She finds Scott, he gives her some money to start a new life, and she is forced to dope him as he turns. Back in Las Vegas, though, Vanderhoe appears to have survived. He exits the vault with the money, finds a car, and then heads to an airport where he bribes the staff to fly him to Mexico City. Shortly after chugging some champagne, he starts to feel lightheaded, so he heads to the bathroom, and there he finds out he was actually bitten by the Alpha, as Dieter wasn't fast enough. So now the adventure begins again in Mexico City. Okay, so first things first that I want to say, in these videos, they are essentially broken down via context clues and filling in the gaps on missing information. So take A Quiet Place, for instance. In A Quiet Place 1, quite literally, we see the creatures move through the water in a way that would indicate they are natural swimmers. But in A Quiet Place 2, I keep getting the comment, this didn't age well, or they can't swim, bro. So the only thing I can imagine is that they don't swim in that movie, which seems a little dumb, but that means that we'll have to revisit that. So in this movie in particular, a whole cinematic universe is planned. So what I'm about to cover is the hypothetical science behind these infected based on what we have seen, how they have survived this long, and what was up with Metal Face and the Blue Hue crew. So first things first, let's start from the beginning, shall we? The original Alpha, who colloquially known as Zeus, was Patient Zero. It's pretty clear at some point he was a soldier based on the high and tight he's got going on with his hair when he actually originally breaks containment, meaning likely that this was a super soldier project, not just some random fine or contracted disease. The concept of a super soldier in this movie is pretty clearly stated all over the place. Between the speed at which Zeus can move from running, the jumping far outclasses any normal human's ability, plus the strength displayed when he literally pulls off another soldier's jaw would be pretty indicative of basically this soldier has strength outside of what his standard meat suit would provide. Getting a good look at him, muscular mass does appear to have been higher than what would be assumed to be standard. Now, there are some ridiculously swole soldiers out there, but this guy was like bodybuilder physique. All these indicators, not to mention where he was being held, again point to the hypothesis that Area 51 was working on a super soldier program to increase resilience in battle as well as durability. We see the soldiers open up on the guy with everything they had, and surely they landed enough shots to turn the organs into Swiss cheese, and yet they could not drop him nor put enough damage downrange to stop his attack. And this would likely mean that while the central nervous system is at the helm controlling the body itself may no longer be in a life support role that it once was, which again, for a super soldier, would be quite important to function this way, as they would not have to feed themselves as regularly, and they could sustain wounds that would not be otherwise survivable, and then they could also just take out another human pretty easily. And really, just to kind of put all of it into perspective, surviving hostile environments like, say, a desert in the southwest United States, all of this would be quite a boost to any project that was being worked on. So let's discuss the durability even further based on the clues we find throughout the movie. What I love about this movie is that they did everything in a fairly subtle way. If you knew where to look and when to listen, you could see what was being hinted at all over the place, but it's never too in your face about it. When the guard measures the girl's temperature, the first thing he says is that she's down a few decimals in a threatening manner, which means something else is happening within the body of a person besides what we would standardly assume. When your body is invaded by anything natural that is, its first inclination is to raise the temperature of the meat suit. When it does this, the protective mechanism makes it harder for bacteria to grow and thrive as the environment changes to suboptimal levels. This can actually slow down bacterial division. The same works with viruses. They do well at normal body temperatures because that's what they have adapted to. This would also activate the immune system to have a stronger response, as this is basically a cue to bring down the hammer. The thing that your body doesn't do is drop temperature. Why would it? After all, you need to survive while fighting this infection, slowing down your body's response to some infection by making you colder and thus slowing down your metabolism would be pretty bad for your longevity. Now, this isn't to say that your body doesn't go the other way with it. One time in my life, I had a fever of 105 degrees and I probably should have gone to the hospital, but never did. I just remember hallucinating my family walked into the room, which was pretty fun, but your brain does start cooking at around 106 degrees, which as you might guess, isn't great. So why would my body prefer to raise temperature even to detriment? Well, that's because that's how our bodies have evolved to fight infection. So again, dropping temperature is fairly rare. rare. It can happen when you have sepsis or an extremely small percentage of the population have shown that they have kind of evolved a different pathway when dealing with infections, so they do lower their body temperatures. But again, it's really rare. So rare that the government wouldn't create a standard measuring unit to know if you were infected by how many degrees your body had dropped to. So what does this rambling mean? Well, it's pretty clear to me that upon your infection, a change within your body begins to take place that is cutting out the need for metabolism, or at least diminishing your body's role as life support. Instead, something else becomes a life support for your body, and as a result of this, less heat is produced within the meat suit in the early stages, and that is the first thing that's noticed. Such as when Vanderho was touched by the flight attendant on his arm and she said that his skin was freezing. After his infection, the temperature began to drop rapidly. So before giving away what's going on, there are further clues as to the diminishment of the body's role in keeping you alive. The shamblers who didn't get out of the sun and instead kept crowding the walls were still subjected to the blistering heat, and eventually their outer layers, such as their skin, eyes, nose, mucosa membranes, all of that would quickly become desiccated. It really just becomes about water loss at that point, which is basically a law of this planet. If you have more water than your environment and you add heat, well, there you go, you're losing water. However, as Lily mentions, when it rains, they come back for a few hours, only to dry out again, meaning that all those bodies piled up near the walls are still alive. They're just kind of in a dormant state, such as like a suspended animation. So how are they living if surely they have completely dried up? Well, prior to answering that, because obviously I want you to listen to more of this, we need to look even further to the few strange infected that we see at random and rarely in certain areas of the movie. The most clear example is the infected that Guzman takes out, and it's only seen for a few frames. It was not some televised event or it showed Guzman as having some giant response to seeing this, but after the skin on the face of the infected was ripped off, underneath we see a clear metallic skull and a blue eye. Guzman was still able to put it down nonetheless with a headshot, but that is a dead giveaway as to what we are seeing in this movie and a possible hierarchy forming between alphas and shamblers. There are a few different versions of the infected that we have seen. You have those who are infected by the alpha themselves, one generation out, who are turned into almost quasi-alphas. They are more intelligent, stronger than a regular person, and faster. Now, compared to the alpha, they are in no way superior. In fact, Zeus could probably completely Shrek them if they were able to get out of line, but likely that's not going to happen since they seem to be under the sway of him after they are bitten. But the first generation of Zeus's infected are quite formidable and still share a lot of the same super soldier characteristics that he had. As the infection continued to spread out further into the surrounding area, eventually many generations of infected later by a sub-alpha would bite a person, who would then bite another, who would then bite another, and so on and so forth. It would appear a change would begin to take place, one that would lead to a mindless infected shuffling around, standing in dangerous environments that decrease longevity, but still keeping the same or at least a similar durability that Zeus has. We see that these bodies are in fact alive, not just the shamblers, but also Zeus and his band of infected as well. So remember the high and tight I mentioned earlier concerning Zeus's hair? Well, I mentioned it for a reason, because now when we see him, the length has increased, and that means the body of Zeus is still very much so alive, producing hair, undergoing cellular metabolism, cellular division, all the things needed to keep it alive. But if something else is taking over the cellular metabolism, then why would his body technically still be alive? Well, because again, if you are creating a super soldier, you want a soldier, not a machine. But combining the two would yield some pretty interesting results. There is this idea that humanity is basically at the precipice of what our brains are capable of. If the brain gets much larger, which I have mentioned in several videos as of late, then it would slow down our ability to think due to more neurons being in the way, pretty much, thus hindering our intellect. If we stay the same, we can learn more, but we may hit a plateau eventually, and that's just the limit. But using our big brainy brains, there may likely be a way around the issue, but what makes it most interesting is it's right at the edge of our limits that our brains are able to grasp a tool to get around that limit, almost making it seem like it's a universal barrier to species if they are to obtain this new tool. This tool is basically grafting machines into our body. The thinking is that our bodies wear out from age, bones break, muscles become less strong, genetic damage mounts. We will turn to machines to fix the issue, which we sort of do now with prosthetic limbs, pacemakers, and spinal stimulators, which at a certain point will become commonplace, sort of like with Cyberpunk 2077. So eventually we will have to ditch the name Homo sapiens, and the next step is theorized, or hypothesized anyways, to be Homo cyborgus. As the modifications to our meat suits become more and more pronounced, eventually we will start working on alterations to the brain itself. Things like microfilament optics, for instance, could be a way to bypass the speed barrier presented by nervous tissue and how slow it fires, meaning that if we can speed things up, we could quite possibly have more intelligence and larger brains waiting for us on the other side. Eventually, it would get to the point where our bodies would wither and decay, considering they're organic, and we would be left with the machine us, and the new evolutionary step known as Homo machinus. miss. An interesting idea to be sure, but the point of all this is to show we are already thinking about, as a species, how to advance past what our bodies are capable of. And if I'm sitting here thinking about that, Zack Snyder is thinking about that, and now you're thinking about that, then who's to say that Area 51 wasn't thinking about that? With all that said, what do I believe is happening in this movie? Well, I believe it's the super soldier from the beginning who has been injected with a form of nanite or micromachine roughly the size of a cell, but more probable it's even smaller than that. It's supposed to take direct control of the chemical reaction known as life while leaving the person still in control of their bodies. It appears that the experiment may have gone awry at some point, and likely the intellect level was not at the desirable levels that they wanted, thus the transportation. Or it's even possible they were doing this Resident Evil style and he was being sent out on his first mission, but due to a couple getting freaky in their car, it instead released it on the American public. So now that the cards are on the table, and invariably in a few years another movie will come out saying it's a freaking alien virus or some crap despite the machine components that we are seeing within the infected, let's discuss how it affects the body and how it may be able to keep the meat suit motivated and moving throughout all the damage it receives and the hostile environment conditions. As I have mentioned, we are nothing much more than chemical reactions. I mean, I personally believe there's a soul in there also, but everyone's got to make their own call on that one. But what's interesting about our bodies is, what is death? Well, death is considered medically by the stopping of the heart, and true death is brain death. But even during these points in time, a person who is clinically brain dead can have their bodies kept alive, meaning that they aren't at the helm, but they are still technically alive. The chemical reaction of life is still continuing. When a person's heart stops, even then, the brain is still alive. Signals are being sent between neurons, chemical reactions in the body are still taking place, cells are undergoing mitosis and cellular metabolism. The fact is, the line of death is incredibly muddled. It's blurry. It doesn't make any sense until about 20 minutes later when you are truly gone. But even then, they brought up a kid from underneath the ice who had been down there for like an hour and they revived him, so even metabolism stopping isn't technically the end either. The reason I bring this up is, a chemical reaction conducts itself because of the laws of nature and physics. If you have too much positive charge here, it's going to attract ions from over there. If you have more water there and a salty substance here, osmosis will draw that water out. These are passive movements that allow for life to take hold, and then life itself will become more active about it, as such with active transporting nutrients across gradients, because that's what cells need. Now you can get to the point where a cell is not capable of pulling this off, which leads to cellular death. This may be because the DNA is just too damaged to form the right proteins, ATP is too low, or in general it's just reached its max limit on what it's capable of. But you live and expire based on what cells can do and what they can't do. I believe the Super Soldier Project was an attempt to overcome this natural life event. Adding in nanites that appear to be blue in coloring, I would say they are hijacking certain cells and are supposed to leave others alone. In terms of the hijacked cells, muscle, skeletal, and endothelial would likely be the targeted ones, but I believe the nervous system may have been a bleed over effect as it wasn't supposed to, and this is in the alphas that we have seen. Likely also the sex cells are infected to a degree but still functional. So these mechanical proteins would actually enter a cell and in fact may actually be organic in nature themselves instead of metallic, and then use the body to build proteins, which may be important as to why we see this kind of fall apart later. But as the machines enter the cell, they can assume the role of DNA. They would replicate themselves further using the naturally occurring structures within the cell, such as the ribosomes and endoplasmic reticulum. And here, these other proteins would continue to spread across the body, such as when we see them move into the bloodstream and then enter more cells, speeding up the process. Once the body was saturated with these cells, again, likely they would have assumed the role of DNA within the body, directing the cell's functions. Likely, since it's a nanite, it could move materials needed for the cell into the cell or perform the metabolism itself within the cell, meaning that heat production would be decreased as it assumes cellular functions. While doing this, the body's temperature would continue to drop as the cells were more likely aided in virtually everything. Which, I know, it sounds like a weird concept, but if you think about it, we are a grouping of cells that use machines all the time. A machine aiding a cell in its ability to keep the body alive might not be as strange as you think. Anyhow, this would have some pretty far-reaching consequences, both good and bad. The good consequences are, let's say you take some pretty heavy damage. Considering the nanites in the body are aiding the cells in their tasks, things that might outright cause a cell to stop functioning don't happen as the nanites keep the cell functional. So holes in your body, normally a game ender, right? Rectified by the nanites, keeping the cells that weren't affected in the immediate area alive and likely ramping up mitosis to heal and providing cells with oxygen. Another good consequence, piggybacking off the idea of increased healing factor, is muscle contractions. Most know this, but if you didn't know, we only use about a third of our strength that we are capable of. Bodybuilders have been known to use roughly about 50% through extreme training, and if you are hopped up on adrenaline, some have been shown to use about 80% of their strength, which literally tore muscle from bone. The point of this is, because we don't use all of our strength, our body stays stays functional for longer. It's protected from damage. If we had an increased healing factor brought on by the nanites, then our bodies could afford to use more strength than normal, as it wouldn't be so detrimental. Of course, this would require alterations to the brain to do this, because it's really just a baseline that we don't use as much. Another good consequence would be bone strength. As we have seen with the one infected who got domed, his skeleton had taken on a metallic appearance, indicating that materials in the body itself may have changed. Now, this is not likely graft or intentionally changed by, say, like some shadow facility, but this would say to me that when elements from outside the environment enter the body, they might be being incorporated into the body itself, kind of like how radium can actually replace calcium on our bones, or it could be used to create more nanites which cover the bone, thus reinforcing the area. So now this all seems pretty good. Stronger, more durable, intellect kind of stays, but it's clear that considering the state Las Vegas finds itself in, something went wrong. And I think it comes down to something as easy as how do you stop a protein from entering the nervous system and affecting it? Odds are you can't. It's clear that with the original Alpha, he was impacted in ways that would be less conducive. Considering the nanites would take control of all the other cells and assume the role of genetic information, that's the hypothesis I'm running with, it would be pretty clear the nervous system, more specifically the brain and spinal cord, would befall the same fate, which may also be why he's able to access more of his strength because the brain itself has been changed. So likely this Alpha is hindered due to interference of the nanites splitting his thinking possibly into two lines. The first is to create more like him and reproduce, which is a very human trait. Pretty much animals want to reproduce. The second line of thinking, which may be more of the machine influence in the acquisition of materials from the environment, which as he abducts uninfected and changes them, he has his queen accept offerings to bring back. Either they can choose to eat or choose to turn. Because of the nanites' influence on the body, likely eating isn't as necessary as it is for you or I, but replenishment of basic chemicals would be necessary, but it's never really shown what they're eating to sustain themselves. Another bad consequence of the nanites, and the final point I will make, which supports the body's replication method, is that the further downstream you get, the more animalistic you become. At its core, to the shamblers, the nanites are still actively protecting the body in certain ways, allowing the cells to enter a state of dormancy, and then when it rains, they rehydrate and get back up. But depending on who you were bit by, think of it as like making a copy of a copy of a copy. The more copies you make, the more aberrations in the picture become apparent until eventually it looks nothing like it originally should. The same idea can be applied to these nanites. As the cells made these copies, mistakes would likely be made. Then these nanites would go on to infect others, where more mistakes were made, until ultimately you have this super durable infected, but the instructions, specifically concerning the instructions on the central nervous system, basically become a garbled mess. And then you are left with a base instinct to survive and replenish, but the intelligence has gone completely out the window. And also, I want to point out something. It's interesting that we actually make nanites that kind of look like viruses, isn't it? And technically viruses, depending on who you're talking to, aren't technically alive. Very strange. So this would lead me to believe, based on the fact that all the cells are impacted to a degree, that only Zeus and his tribe would be capable of actually reproducing, as the sex cells and the shamblers would either likely be completely screwed up or non-functional, which, let's talk about that as well for a moment. It's pretty clear, as I have stated with all this, the body is most certainly alive, and depending on how pure the instructions of the nanites are on a cellular basis, this would have a pretty profound impact on the organism as a whole. Zeus was well above his pack, but likely at or just below the intelligence of a normal human being. Those a generation below would likely be well below the average intelligence of a human, but by no means an animal. However, being that humans are animal, old urges die hard, if you know what I'm saying. So the sex cells could be affected by the nanites or left completely alone. Either way, they are still functional enough to produce offspring for Zeus and the queen. The baby, being from the queen's body, was immediately infected with those nanites, but after the queen's end, likely the body of it was too frail to keep alive and may not have had the nutrition levels required. We have seen, however, that the nanites can keep infected alive in crazy odds. The queen, for instance, despite being separated from her spinal cord, still had control of her brain and head, meaning that since the body is alive and the cells are alive, this would indicate again that the nanites are running the metabolism of the cells to keep them going. But the issue is, these infected are not invincible. The chemical reaction of life still needs to keep going, or at minimum, the central nervous system still needs to be in control, as the nanites do not appear to have a will of their own, just instructions to be followed to aid the body. Because of this, destroying the brain of the person will render the body absolutely useless. Now, it may very well still actually be alive, however, but without the complex system of neurons to communicate and interpret life, well, then it's really nothing more than just a giant mass of cancer cells. Not sapient by any means, not even sentient, as there is really nothing there to interpret life. But again, likely the body is still alive and kicking, it's just really been turned into a vegetable. So to sum this up, I believe what we are seeing in Las Vegas is a result of a super soldier program gone wrong. The nanites injected into the original soldier were an attempt to sidestep the natural process processes to keep our bodies alive and aid in creating a person who was well outside the range of what a normal soldier could do. However, with the nanites, it's hard to direct or account for possible changes in the body, and this soldier may have had his mind altered by them, attacking others, and then he infected the entire city, which would ultimately become more and more diluted down the line, leaving the infected to become less and less capable as the infection continued generations out.